In this video, we're going to talk about molecules in the solid state. In the solid state, molecules are packed fairly closely and bound by inter or intramolecular forces. And those molecules may come together, say they're ions, and they're positive and negative ions, and if they're randomly organized in there, although bound by opposite charges, this is considered an amorphous structure. So an example of that, non-ionic but covalently bound, is glass. But more probable or more likely, whenever particles start to bond together, they'll bond in an organized manner. And these materials are then called crystalline. Crystal structure is often referred to as the lattice or the lattice structure. Examples of that are diamonds or minerals, many of the things like in a cave when you see a nice deposit. So what are the forces that hold crystalline solids together? If we started with the lower end of things, intermolecular forces such as London forces, we might be familiar with iodine. And you know the iodine molecule is diatomic. The iodine is bound to itself with a strong covalent bond, but these are very large molecules because of their position on the periodic table. And so they're polarizable, so at any moment you might have these what we call London forces or weak van der Waals attraction between these molecules for each other. And therefore, they do form crystals. So here's some iodine crystals that have been re-crystallized on top of on a cold glass surface. So here I'm drawing in the weak London forces that attract the iodine molecules to each other. And this has a melting point of 114 degrees C. So even though it's a weak attraction, because of the polarizability, it actually ends up being a fairly significant a force of attraction with that high boiling point. A different type of intermolecular attraction could be either dipole-dipole or hydrogen bonds, and the most famous one we're familiar with is water, where the dipoles of water, the negative end attracts of the oxygen attracts for the positive end of the hydrogen. So this is the hydrogen bond acceptor, and this is the hydrogen bond donator. It donates lone pairs of electrons. But anyway, we know that water bonds to itself through these polar bonds, and it makes familiar ice structures. Another example of a crystalline solid is seen in Kevlar, which is a long polyaramid, the aramid group shown right here, and is connected by these aromatic phenyl rings. This is a very high strength polymer. It's used actually in bulletproof clothing. So what gives rise to this strength? Well, first there's the covalent bonding, which makes the chain itself. Everything that connects the polyaramid groups to each other and then to the rings. Secondly, there's these long straight chains, and they're especially straightened out because of this arrangement of the aramid group on either side of the phenyl rings. These long chains are connected to each other through strong hydrogen bonding with the hydrogen acceptors and then the oxygen donators. But there's also another force in play, and that is that these rings can exhibit strong van der Waals attraction for each other because they lay flat and can lay on top of each other. So each one of these rings exhibits strong London force. And that gives rise to this very, very strong crystal. Another solid is ionic compounds, which we're probably most familiar with. If you copper and sulfate, and line them in such a manner that sulfates are surrounded by the positive copper and vice versa. As the water is driven off and these form naturally, they'll form into these crystalline structures. And if you look at this strong ionic bonding here, it's more of an intramolecular force. It, decomposition point is 650 degrees C. If that would be an error, the lattice energy would break and oxygen could react with the copper and make copper oxide. Finally, metallic compounds, just the metals we're familiar with, like copper, like in the copper penny. These basically are loosely shared electrons in a metallic bond. This has a very high melting point. And finally, another intramolecular type of force that holds together these crystalline solids, the kind of covalent network which you'd find in diamonds. So diamonds really is made up all of carbon, but each of the tetrahedral carbons can be bound to other carbons around it, four other carbons around it. This makes this very crystalline structure, which we're familiar with. So I'm going to explain to you how we've determined the location and the density of all these atoms. It's something called X-ray crystallography, but before we get into that, I need to kind of backtrack and explain a little physics. If you were to look at a wave, whether it be a water wave, an electromagnetic wave, and you look at the wavelength, the distance from crest to crest in a repeating cycle, if that wavelength is about the same size as an opening that it's trying to go through, that wave will actually bend and turn on its way through. That's called diffraction. Okay? So this is a top view of the ocean going through these openings, and you can see that the wavelength is a little longer or very close to the opening size, and so it actually diffracts. It bends and turns as it goes through this opening. So there was a guy named Bragg who received the Nobel Prize in Physics in 1915, and what he figured out was the same thing. If you take an X-ray and you pass it through crystals, the atom spacing in there is very close, so we know it's very small, but that spacing in there is very close in wavelength to an X-ray, so consequently as the X-rays pass through the crystal, they actually start to bend. And what he observed was those X-rays came out on the other side with these bright, distinct spots that were spaced apart from each other in a very systematic manner. So if I take that same diagram and I just focus on just this, the crystal itself, and we expand that up, here's what we think is going on in there, is that as the incident beam comes in through the lattice structure, the atoms are spaced about the same distance as the wavelength of the X-rays that are coming in. Okay, so they bend, they diffract, and they come over to the screen, which is analogous to this. So if I took in these X-rays, they diffract, they bend, they come out. And if you place that screen in the right place so that this outgoing wave, the crest, or it's in phase with other waves around it, it'll actually increase in magnitude and make this bright spot. So if you get this focal point in the right position, you're going to have constructive interference and the amplitude of this wave is going to actually build and you'll get a bright spot. So it's the placement of the screen and the angle at which it's placed, which are somehow related to these very small intermolecular distances. So this is kind of nice. And now, look in our diagram. This is getting back to the simplified crystal that I'd drawn. We have now focused on the red atoms here. And we've got it positioned right so that those come in onto the screen and they're highlighted. But you could imagine that if you were to just simply move the screen over, then you could probably focus on the blue points just as easily, right? So now we're focusing on the blue points. And same principles apply. And you could find where those focus. Just to help you understand the math, it really is a kind of simple geometry. Here's Bragg's equation. It says this distance, which is very small, the distance between these two atoms, and is related to the angle. So that's the angle at which the screen is placed, and it's placed such that the focal point comes in at the crest. Okay? And one of the tricks is this. As this part of the wave just basically diffracts, it's only going to be in phase with a wave that diffracts through this distance, so it's a longer turning radius, right? That's one wavelength, and then this wave coming through will be in phase with the wave above it. Okay, so the formula says this. First off, here's the wavelength from the instrument. We know that because we know the frequency of the X-ray that's being shot towards this crystal. N is a complete wavelength, so it's just any integer, 1, 2, 3, to make up the difference to keep the waves in phase. And then sine of theta is actually the sine of this angle theta up to where the screen is caught. And if you do this math, you basically can solve for D, which is actually the very small distance between these two atom centers. So now that we know that we can actually figure out the distance between these atoms, what have we discovered with that? Most of these are analyzed by what's called a unit cell, and that is the first repeatable unit that I could pull out of this crystal. The first repeatable unit of atoms. And if I could pull that out of there and just kind of square it up, and we could analyze this, called a unit cell. Points in the unit cell actually represent the center of atoms. But these are the 14 Bravais lattices that really describe all of the crystalline solids that we know of from all flavors, whether they're ions or they're made from polymers or atomic solids. And in the next set of slides, I'm going to really tear into just the cubic structures, which is what you need for general chemistry too. But before we do that, I just want you to appreciate why we would want a crystal structure. Here's a cubic structure, a simple cubic structure, an atom on each corner. And if I was really to explode that up and look at the atoms, they would be more like this. And polonium atoms actually crystallize in a simple cubic structure. Well, for one thing, they can reveal the atomic, ionic, and molecular size. And as we know from our chemistry, the size of the atom is very important for the lattice energy, how much attraction, intram and intermolecular attraction they have for each other. It gives rise to polarizability, and it literally gives size to density. The other thing is crystallinity is often the key to strength, as we kind of demonstrated with Kevlar. And finally, secondary and tertiary structure is often the key to function and reactivity. What atoms are there and what they're surrounded by is really the key to how active those atoms are. So I'm going to give you a little demonstration how crystallography could actually help us determine the molecular size. All right, so what I wanted to show you is a little demonstration how crystallinity helps you to do atomic size. So I have these three golf balls, and let's just say that this is the unit cell, this box. So I actually have fit these in the unit cell, so they maximize that. And I could take a measurement of the unit cell now, say, oh, that's 12 centimeters is what that comes out to, and divide it by the three golf balls in there, and know that each golf ball is indeed approximately 4 centimeters apiece. And that's exactly what we're going to do when we do unit cell measurements. Another factor of why we want to know about crystallinity is it's related to strength. Here's Kevlar, which we talked about earlier. It's this nice polyaramid. It's very organized. And as we talked about, it has the hydrogen bonds, and it also has van der Waals attractions between the rings. So these are what gives rise to bulletproof vests, but with a little bit of change in structure where instead of connecting these aramid groups opposite the ring in what we call the paraconfiguration. And now if I just connect it one carbon over in what's called the metaconfiguration, see how it looks like an upside down M in there. Now all of a sudden the crystallinity is affected because of tension it puts on this hydrogen bond, and it opens this up and kind of makes little air pockets in here. And so the strength goes down, and this is the structure of Nomex, which is not as strong as Kevlar. It is still fairly robust, and that has to do with the phenyl and aromatic groups. But these open pockets are actually useful for managing heat, and this particular material is what you put in fireproof clothing. And finally, crystallinity is actually the key to function. So let me see if I can explain this. We're gonna work on a Henry reaction in which you basically take an aldehyde, and the aldehyde reduces into an alcohol. And that is done catalytically. This particular change from an aldehyde to this alcohol and nitro group is very useful for a lot of drug synthesis. But in order to understand the crystalline structure and function, you need to understand that this is actually a stereospecific center. So in order to understand that, I'm going to put this other hydrogen that's in there, that's implied. This is a tetrahedral shape, so this alcohol group is actually pushed back behind the plane of the slide, and this hydrogen is sticking out of the slide. And then this branch to the phenyl ring and the branch to the NO2 are actually within the plane of the slide. So let's pretend that if you were to look at that, that's like a left hand with the thumb back, like the alcohol is back. That's like your thumb being back. So let's just do a very simple switch and put the hydrogen back and bring the alcohol forward. Okay? And that would be like your right hand with the thumb forward now. So this is left-handed and right-handed. And just like you shake people's hands traditionally with your right hand, in the same manner, this molecule only connect into drug receptor site with a right-handed receptor. And the left-handed receptor wouldn't actually be accepted in that drug site. So even though these molecules look exactly the same because it's stereospecific, it may not or it won't actually be accepted by the acceptor within the body. That we make sure this reaction takes place in a way that's very stereospecific. So now that you understand that, you can understand this reaction. So the catalyst that makes this happen is this copper complex. And as it is, if I just put this copper complex as it is, I would have 82% yield, and it would be 62% specific, let's say for the right-handed type of molecule. So here's where crystallinity comes in. These researchers from India basically took a zeolite material or a mineral. This is a zeolite structure. It actually has this big open cage inside of here. See this open hole? And so what these researchers did is they synthesized this catalyst inside that hole. So here's the structure of that, based on a molecular model. And they were able to run the same reaction, increase their yield by 10%, and increase their stereospecificity by 20%. So that's where crystalline structure could lead to function. And there's many, many molecules inside your body that run exactly with the same idea, where it's very stereospecific. So I hope I've helped you understand molecules in the solid state and given you a good introduction to crystal structure, which we'll dive into in a little more detail in the next set of slides.